Stemming from the needs of many, one organization has stepped forward working consistently to tackle a disease that globally has become an increasing cause of morbidity and mortality, cancer. The diversity of types of cancers highlights the need for control activities to fully consider cancer patterns, given that different cancers may be amenable to primary prevention, early detection, screening, and treatment. The Belize Cancer Society, a local organization which opened its services to thousands of Belizeans over its almost 20 years of operations, has consistently worked to meet its mission and is now a significant player in the health and medical environment, as well as policy planning for the national response to this disease.
The Cancer Society's role is a very significant one now. We are at the policy level. We started out with the community. We have built that community, wave and base.
With critical partnerships from regional and international organizations like the Healthy Caribbean Coalition, UNESCO, and PAHO, the Belize Cancer Society has successfully turned focus squarely on the many forms of cancer, and of recent, one type, cervical cancer.
We are considered a serious partner by the Ministry of Health. We partner with other organizations like the Belize Family Life Association. When we call Carthusian Memorial Hospital, we're taken seriously when we lobby for our patients, for a reduction in fees and so on. And when we call our private sector partners, they offer as best as they can offer.
In full consideration that cervical cancer is a disease deemed to be completely preventable, the organization's public education and advocacy has cast a broad net, bringing together the support of national government and medical professionals, local and international, as well as national private sector entities with a view to educate the general public while taking action at a comprehensive level. While cervical cancer is considered one of the most preventable forms of the disease, a mere look at the statistics does not convey this impression. In 2008, on the global scene, 57 million deaths occurred globally, with 36 million, almost two-thirds, due to non-communicable diseases. These diseases comprised mostly cardiovascular diseases, diabetes, chronic lung diseases, and most notably, cancers. Cancer is the second leading cause of non-communicable disease deaths globally, with 7.6 million deaths in 2008, of which two-thirds owing to cancer in low and middle-income countries like Belize. In Belize, even with the absence of a national cancer registry, which remains a goal of both the Ministry of Health and the Belize Cancer Society, the anecdotal accounts from medical practitioners on the ground are telling a sad but completely preventable story of a scourge, a situation rightly demanding that concerted action be taken. In the course of this focus, an impressive network of professionals have come together alongside the Ministry of Health, comprising first the National Commission for Non-Communicable Diseases and the National Cervical Cancer Committee, which is currently chaired by the Belize Cancer Society. The work has crystallized what was already medically known, that is, that stemming cervical cancer needs a broader focus, one that must be anchored in its root cause, that of HPV or the human papilloma virus.
Unfortunately, we see a number of wives who are afflicted. You know, women who have, probably they will say to you, that was the only man in my life. But you don't know if you were the only woman in his life. So these are the kinds of discourse, as blunt as sometimes hard, but we have to be real. Young girls are having sex with boys. Young girls are having sex with older men. And we do know that the men carry the virus as well, right? And so therefore, we have to give that level of protection. Based on what we're seeing, men engage in anal sex as well, right? And so what we want to ensure is that the anus being a passage is also protected as well from the entry of the virus.
The HPV or human papilloma virus is carried via sexual contact, skin to skin or genital to genital. The virus's less infectious strains are responsible for genital warts, but at its most destructive is the cause of cervical cancer, which has been realized as one of, if not the most frequent killer, of our Belizean young women. While that is its devastation to females, HPV is chiefly known as the cause of several cancers: oral, throat, penile cancer, as well as anal cancer, all owing to sexual behaviors and practices. It is not possible to tell if a person is infected with the virus and may be passed back and forth from person to person among sexual partners, with a person being able to be infected multiple times even after the body may have successfully rid itself of the virus on previous infections.
HPV, human papilloma virus, we don't know where it came from. We don't know where all viruses come from, but we do know that it likes the cervix and the anal canal as well, primarily. It can be found other places. It is the most common virus that causes a sexually transmitted infection. Start with what it can cause, right? In the female, they have different strains of it. So there are some that will cause low risk strains, which means that they won't cause a cancer, but they will cause something. Everybody knows warts, genital warts, for instance. So, and that's not cancerous, but it's easily spread, and it has negative connotations with that. So you have genital warts, you have respiratory papillomas that can occur when the baby is being born through that the vagina with a copious amount of genital warts, and that now requires, think of the warts, but it's in the back of the larynx where you breathe from, basically. You have cervical cancer, vaginal cancer, vulva, which is the lips, cancers as well, and anal cancer, or rectal cancer, or not rectal, anal cancer. In the men, you have the genital warts, the same papillomas, it doesn't matter which sex for the babies, and anal cancer is one of their main things as well, and oropharyngeal cancers. That is the primary one for them now, right? It's actually out now that it's the number one cause of the oral cancers. It's bypass tobacco.
We know that people get very nervous when we speak about HPV virus. I think we really need to be honest. Let's talk about what we as sexual human beings, what our practices are, and if we know that this is part of our sexual health. We take a bath every day, we do other things every day, but we can't see our cervix. And so then the health of the cervix should be a matter for both partners, a husband and a wife, a partner, a boyfriend, a lover. It should be a part of your concern.
The concern over the potentially devastating impact of our sexual practices has presented huge medical challenges for our women and men. The general advice given to control sexually transmitted infections applies similarly with HPV. Abstinence, limiting sexual partners, condom use, and in the case of women's sexual and reproductive health, frequent pap smears starting at age 21. And now the consideration is to commence pap screenings at an earlier age and mark its necessity based on the female's commencement of sexual intercourse.
Although we have the services available in public sector facilities, private sector, and NGOs, last year, for example, 2013, we only managed to do 8,500 pap smears in the public sector. And more or less similar amount would add up from the other sectors, which is private and NGO. But for our country to really curb the incidence and the mortality rates due to cervical cancer, one would need to have a coverage of 80% plus. We did a research in 2004, 2005, and at household level, And the coverage for a pap smear was at 62. So we might probably be around that same figure, hopefully. But we definitely need to do more investment in screening services.
Even though the protocol for the ministry is stating, well, no pap smear until after age 20, we are finding where we are having women who are within their adolescent years with cervical cancer. So we go ahead and we do the pap smears.
Cervical cancer is caused by the human papillomavirus called HPV, and it is a changes that occur at the level of the cervix. This is the mouth of the womb, the boca. And if left untreated, that virus will then eventually change to a cancer.
Because Belizeans only visit the doctor when they're ill, the education process for cervical cancer and HPV stresses visiting the doctor more regularly, retrieving results of medical tests, and following up on your health care. Failing the adoption of that practice, medical professionals sadly report that the situation of cervical cancer in Belize places them in the difficult position of communicating to very young women that they have cervical cancer, and all too often, late stages of the disease. This grounds the Ministry of Health policies of reaching women across Belize with critical services and education.
We do the pap smear campaigns within communities. We try and ensure that we reach all the communities. Some of them are relatively small, so you might not get as much women as you would want. So we move from one community to the other. We also collaborate with HECOPAB, which is the Health Education Bureau for our region. And they assist us during the campaigns with health education. So right there, the women are sitting down waiting for a pap smear, and we have persons, whether community health worker or HECOPAB health educators, who are informing them, keeping them informed.
The education continues to inform, implore, and inject that with early detection, treatment is available right here in Belize for the disease. However, the key remains detecting it early.
On a pap smear, you find evidence of it. There are different grades of it. And so you look at the age of the person and the grade of the actual HPV that you're seeing. And they will need to do a colposcopy. The colposcopy now gives me a macroscopic view. So using the microscope so I can, it magnifies everything for me. And I will take a biopsy. With that, I'm going to confirm the diagnosis, because what the pap smear is showing you is what's been shed. It doesn't tell me in the tissue itself, the meat of the matter itself. So I'm going to confirm the diagnosis and see the worst stage that they are. And then based on that, they'll get the treatment. We have what you call visual inspection with acetic acid, and that is actually offered here, BFLA by Mahogany Street offers that. And I know in PG they have persons who have been trained. I know Dr. Terry is one of them. And that is not a pap smear, but it can pick up. At colposcopy, we utilize the VIA procedure. We give them vinegar, it's actually acetic acid, and you put it onto the cervix, just with a Q-tip, and you check for the changes. The virus will change the color of the, with a reaction occurs, and it'll become white, aceto-white. And with that, they know this cervix is invaded with it. The treatment can be something called cold coagulation or cryotherapy, where we literally freeze it off like frostbite. You make it very, very cold, and it'll have the cells shed. And what we hope, because we didn't destroy the virus, we just destroyed the area that the virus had invaded. And we will continue surveillance with that person, more frequent pap smears, to see that their own immune system got rid of the remainder of the virus. But they need to be continued surveillance for 20 years. And that's when you can say, okay, I'm cured of this. If they're further along, in the sense that it's a higher grade, then they'll get a procedure, it's called a LEAP or a LETS, which is a large loop excision of the transformation zone. And that's when you take, it's more of a scoop, like an ice cream scoop of the area. So it's a bigger area, it's deeper, so we get a bigger depth in there. We also remove, again, these are done in an office procedure. So you don't need to be put under. No anesthesia is necessary. Local, we give them some injections there, numb the area, and they walk out the clinic just the same. Nobody knows what's been happening inside there. They don't have any everlasting or long-lasting effects from that. If it is beyond that, then you're talking about a simple hysterectomy. That is for the carcinoma in situ when it's stage zero, and stage one as well. You can offer a simple hysterectomy.
That speaks to the impact of HPV on the female via cervical cancer. But our men and boys are an equally important part of this health situation. The data shows that while abstinence is an ideal, condom use a highly viable option, and reducing sexual partners a recommended lifestyle choice, there is a need for further concerted, deliberate action. The conversation and education has to be initiated to match the real scenario. And for our men and boys, we may also need to employ special considerations.
I believe that information, giving people the information, making the hours of clinic friendly to everyone in terms of providing specific services for men, you know, a men's health section, just as how we would want an adolescent health section.
Data shows, we have checked, there has been surveys on several territories by several organizations. The AIDS Commission has done, BLE's Family Life, Ministry of Health, all have statistics to show that young people have their first sexual encounter at 16 years old, and there are some studies that say 15. So it's in the discussion for men or fathers or boyfriends are important. You can have gonococcal infections, you can have syphilitic infections, hepatitis infections. There are no that can be transmitted. We don't talk about these things sufficiently, and so women are left with the burden of their health care when we should be talking a little bit and taking more responsibility for each other.
Neglecting to take responsibility for ourselves and each other in our relationships can have devastating impacts if infection is left undetected and untreated. Implications that represent emotional and financial costs to families, to the health sector, and even broader national development. Medical professionals insist that cancer, and particularly cervical cancer, can no longer be isolated in a bubble. The costs of inaction can no longer be avoided or ignored.
Cervical cancer is actually the number one cancer that affects female, and between the ages, we use the ages 15 to 44 basically, and that is our working population, that's our mothers, those are the ones that are going to help the future generation.
The generational gap and cultural sensitivities cannot ignore the need for education of parents and our young persons, empowering them to make sound, informed decisions. The public awareness is crucial, ensuring a change in behaviors and sexual practices, lifestyles, as well as in management of personal health. The costs of education and prevention are undoubtedly high, but treatment is by far more devastatingly unaffordable. Cost-benefit analysis has proved across the region that efforts must be deliberate. Integral in that comprehensive policy planning and implementation is the introduction of a national immunization program for the HPV.
We also did, in collaboration with the Pan American Health Organization, a cost effectiveness analysis for the introduction of the HPV vaccine, which is one of the most effective way of preventing cervical cancer through the HPV vaccine. And that proven to be the investment is worthwhile for the prevention of the cervical cancer.
While the medical evidence is broadly accepted, the ministry realizes that introducing a new vaccine to the overall immunization schedule will require re-education and resensitization for individuals, for parents, for families, for males and females, for communities, in short, across the board. Belize has long boasted a high degree of success in our immunization processes. And while our communities are well aware of how vaccines have been helpful in dealing with infections like polio, whooping cough, pneumonia, and more recently hepatitis, the HPV vaccine will now simply provide for future protection of the female and male children as they continue along with their lives as normal.
Well, in general, any vaccine that is put into the market and is administered either through the national programs or in other country in the private market pass very detailed processes before entering into the public use. There are different types of vaccines. You know, in certain vaccines you have what are called attenuated viruses, which means it's a strain of a virus which is going to trigger an immune response. In other type of vaccines, you have elements of the virus which are part of the vaccine itself. But in both cases, basically the idea is to stimulate the immune response.
The target population that we're looking at is 10 to 12 years old. And the point of distribution most effective would be the schools. So obviously we would need to have a lot of discussions with faith-based organizations. We know that schools are run also by faith-based organizations. The Ministry of Education, parents, as much as we can through public awareness. The vaccines are voluntary. So we are envisioning that the school system would have to request authorization from the parents for the child to receive the vaccine, just like we do with other vaccines.
The education process will need all to play a role, and as the program is being developed, the work must include other non-traditional partners.
For instance, a teachers union would be awesome to really have a representative to help us with our communication strategy. Our Chamber of Commerce, again, obviously, we have certain beliefs. We are a group of people in our society, have our faiths, or all our faiths that we believe in, our cultural beliefs. And of course, we belong to the faith-based organizations who represent us. And so I think that as a parent, as a grandparent, I absolutely understand the concerns through and perhaps asking the faith-based organizations to help us to really show the community that there are statistics here that need attention. And I think that we need to work with all of us to find out what is the best way to go about getting this vaccine into its rightful place without all the controversy, and to make sure that people understand the importance of the vaccine.
Accepting the importance of the vaccine is a decision that has at its heart the health of our family members, our community, and our overall development as a country.
I think the main objection is the fact that they believe that they're going to be condoning their child to becoming sexually active. And what I want to say is really it's their upbringing. Right, you talk to them, and there's no difference whether they've had the vaccine before, in that you're going to tell them not to have sex until you're ready, and we don't think you're ready as a teenager, that you're going to use protection when you do so. But this is an additional precaution.
I will use the analogy with the vaccine protection and giving a child a motorbike. For a father who takes his role seriously in terms of the safety of his child will more than likely buy the motorbike along with a helmet and provide some safety tips for his child, being convinced that, you know what, I am going to give my child the opportunity to protect herself against cervical cancer, and that peace of mind to know that the same way you will give that child an education that equips her for the future, you will give them, then why not, the vaccine?
It's a good move. because we are recognizing the importance of attacking this potential threat at a time when we can do primary prevention of it. So despite the cost of it, it's subsidized definitely because we cannot afford it otherwise. It will be cost effective in the future because cervical cancer is very expensive as an for individual and for the country. And it doesn't just affect that woman, it affects her family as well.
We know that eating healthy, exercising regularly, and regular medical checkups are all recommended to prevent a number of illnesses, and cancer is no different. We know that cervical cancer is highly preventable in women who adopt a healthier lifestyle. But while it is important for us as women to look after ourselves, it is also imperative that we look after our teenage girls. I take this opportunity to urge all mothers and fathers to get educated and be informed on the HPV vaccine. Let us protect our girls today for a healthy and cancer-free future.